Hi, you know me. This is Brian Zipsy from Horse Racing Nation. We're here with another Breeders' Cup edition webcast. And how lucky am I? I have a wonderful group of guests tonight. To my left, one of the up-and-coming rising stars in the training game, Joe Sharp. Next to him, I believe they're related now. That's Rosie Napravnik, one of the most successful jockeys of the 21st century. Joe Christopher.
What can you possibly introduce me after those two?
Joe Christopher, the rider of four Kentucky Derby. No, racing ambassador Joe Christopher, and the voice of Churchill Downs, Travis Stone. Guys, we're here to talk, have a little fun, talk some Breeders' Cup. But before we do any of that, I think we should talk to these two a little bit about, a six-month-old baby now? Is it Carson?
Almost five months.
I'm way off. Almost five. How is Carson doing?
He is wonderful. Such a wonderful baby. Really, really great, I feel.
He's definitely out on his pedigree. I mean, we look at him every day and we're like, man, he's such a good kid.
How did he become so little?
But, no,
half,
he's great.
Half trainer, half jockey?
No, he sleeps through the night. He doesn't fuss. He's not easy to please, so he's nothing like getting one of us. But
it's better than I could say for my wife. That's a good thing.
Hope she's not watching.
And he already has a Breeders' Cup win.
Only Breeders' Cup winning baby in
Breeders' Cup winning. That's something to say.
Yeah.
Now you were 7 weeks.
Between 6 and 7 weeks. Yeah.
Wow, what an announcement! That was a big part of last year's Breeders' Cup when you got off on capable after winning the Breeders' Cup distaff, and you announced to the world. You had no idea.
He knew I was pregnant.
Okay. Your mom.
My mom actually found out in that moment. Wow. I was going to tell her. I couldn't tell her. We really couldn't. It was such a big, fat, juicy secret. Like, we really just couldn't tell anybody.
Yeah.
So I was going to tell my mom at dinner that night. And I didn't want to, like, tell the world before I told her. So
you did both at
once?
I
just did it all at once. Yeah.
That was not
at all my plan. Literally, I made that decision, like, as the words were coming out of my mouth.
Very nice.
He had no idea that I was going to. As a matter of fact, I told my sister via text, like, right before that race, that I was going to wait till Sunday. And then it just came out.
So she was surprised.
It was a very emotional win on the filly.
Yeah, untappable winning the Breeders' Cup distaff. I think we might watch that a little bit later, Rosie. Well, since the last time you were in front of a national television audience, you had that big announcement. I guess I should give you the opportunity to make another big announcement. Do you have any big announcements for us tonight? Not to put you on the spot.
I'm not pregnant.
There you go. That's good. All right, Joe, I want to...
I'm pregnant.
Wow.
Just kidding.
After really Sapphire Kitten wins, you guys can make that announcement.
The circle, we'll tell the rest of the world in the winner's circle. Ooh. Just kidding. Not pregnant.
Joe, we had this plan for months.
Yeah.
Just so.
Okay.
All right, Joe. Joe, you've had kind of a meteoric rise in the training world. You went on your own less than a year ago?
A little over a year ago.
Just over a year.
Yeah.
You were with Mike Maker for years.
Yep.
And what prompted you to go out on your own?
I was always raised with the fact that timing is everything in life. I think one of the things that made my start so successful is the fact that I wasn't in a hurry to get started. I had no intentions. A month before I went on my own, to go on my own, everything kind of fell into place. I had the support of the right people. And, I didn't let my ego get in the way, and I kind of sat back, waited until the time was right. And, I just got a lot of support from great owners, a great teacher, several great teachers. And, everything just worked out, and just we stayed with the same program I've always known, and just got lucky.
Got lucky, or a lot of hard work, and you're doing great with it. A lot of your big successes this year, I'm thinking Aztec Brave, Sandbar, One King's Man, they were all claimed by you.
Yeah, we won 7 stakes with horses we claimed this year, so it's been a good year. So, we didn't, obviously everybody gave us, a lot of people gave us opportunities that were great, and I didn't know anything but to start claiming and getting horses in the barn. And with that, we tried, there's 2 bad stories go with every good one, but for the most part, the horses we claimed went on to do well, and, like I said, we won 7 stakes, and, horses are still there, still in the barn, still competing well, and you know, I'm grateful for each one of them, and they're all horses that I'll never forget.
Rosie, who's your favorite Joe Sharp trained horse?
The White Stallion.
The White Stallion. Who's the White Stallion?
Me.
You guys, they planned. They had to.
This show could go a lot of different ways.
No, we claimed a horse called Proterio.
He actually runs on Friday in the undercard. Mm-hmm.
He runs in the third race on Friday. Yeah, he's a horse that we claimed at Saratoga.
He's the one.
And what?
I said we claim him now.
Well, I'll explain my reason for liking him. We claimed him at Saratoga, and I had been over at the harness track with about 13 stalls over there, kind of overseeing by myself on the other side of the isolated planet of Saratoga. But we claimed this horse, and he came with a really bad reputation of, like, not wanting to train and stuff like that. And so, and specifically, don't let Rosie ride him. And so I was like, I can't wait to ride this horse.
Don't let Rosie ride him.
And I'm just like, and he's big and beautiful and gray, and I have a weakness for gray, so I just kind of, I mean, I haven't seen him since Saratoga, honestly. So.
But we'll see him Friday. Good luck. Travis, I think that was an opening for me to start talking about Frosted.
Frosted, sure. There you go. Yeah, I want to ask you about Mike Maker, who I think has been very successful, but still remains one of the most underrated trainers in the country. What are some of the things you learned from him?
You know, it's funny. Mike, I think, is underrated in the fact that Mike's very quiet, very to himself. Mike's not out to please anybody but his owners and each individual horse. And Mike will ship anywhere to win a race. If he can get a halter on it, he'll train it. And he's not after the media. He's not after the limelight. He's not after, you know, he obviously wants to win good races. But Mike, day in, day out, you know, individualizes each owner, each horse. And I learned to do the same thing and not be better than any horse or any owner or any employee, and, you know, just get in there every day and find the best spot for every horse. If you have to ship them to any track that's considered lesser than what a lot of trainers would go to, you know, put your pride aside and go there and, you know, win races at any level. And I think he represents his owners well and does the best job for them, and I think that's the biggest thing I gained from him.
How much is it a balance between being a CEO of a business and a horseman, what you do?
Well, I think that there's definitely, I think trainers are analyzed as being one or the other or both, and I know that I'm a horseman, I know that Mike's a horseman. As far as the CEO part goes, we actually have the same bookkeeper, and they do a phenomenal job, and that makes a lot easier for us. We're the kind of guys that want to go in, train our horse every day, manage our employees, manage our horses, and you guys take care of the rest when it comes to the financial part of it. Having said that, Mike and I are both guys that have come from a very modest background. We didn't come up with money. We didn't come up, you know, in a bad situation, but, you know, it's always on the forefront of my mind to be mindful of ROI and, you know, just trying to get money back on the owner's investments. And you know, I treat every case the same, and I try and do the best for each one of them.
Let's speak a little bit more to that, the managing of the horses and picking horses out to claim. You've won 7 stakes with horses that you've claimed. When you claim them, do you go into that situation with that mindset, maybe we think we can claim this horse and do better with the horse? Are you claiming horse to replace another horse? Do you keep in contact with the owners that say, hey, we're looking for one? I mean, it seems like overwhelming to me, and you have to have a lot of good help in order to be successful, but there's just so much that goes into that. And the general racing public, a lot of people don't understand how it works.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I mean, it's like I said, everybody's different, and every owner's different. Somebody like Mr. Ramsey, you know, he spends hours on end. I mean, I've been to his house, and he has forms all over his desk, and stacked this high, they're turning yellow from the sunlight, and he'll call me most of the time with horses. Having said that, and you know, he does his homework from the rag sheets to the, you know, reading the form, and he'll call me with a horse to claim sometimes spur of the moment, but we get it done. Having said that, he has enough respect. If I call him with a horse, you know, he'll look at it, and if it checks out, you know, he's grateful of that as well. And then on the other side of the spectrum, I have owners that I had an owner, Stephen Wallace with Boilermaker Racing. He sent me money in February at the fairgrounds, and we didn't end up claiming a horse till April at Keeneland. You know, we were very, he's had one shot, one bullet in the gun, and, you know, we claimed Little Ariel, and she's turned out to be a nice filly for him. And so each situation is different, and I try to be cater to their needs. And, you know, I put a lot of time in. I watch a lot of replays, look at the PPs, and I definitely do my homework. You know, you can't, there's no guarantee, but I feel like I have a system that works, and I learn from people with systems that work, and I'm pretty confident when I make a decision to claim one, especially at a higher level.
You have to be confident, though, right? If you go into it claiming a horse and you're not confident about it, like you said, it's not always going to work out.
Right.
I'm taken back all the time, but he's like, I got to have this horse, and I'm like, you do? And, I mean, I can't think, Billy Two Hats is one of them. How many races did we win with him?
Yeah.
And I'm like, are you sure
I claimed
you have
I claimed
to
him off
of
the DNF angle.
Yeah, I did not finish. He claimed him off of being pulled up, being eased
off,
or pulled
banned
up.
Off, yeah.
Eased and banned off. And I'm like, God, you're... I'm glad I'm not in your position, but go ahead. I'll, you know, be supportive. But he is up till midnight many occasions just studying the farm. Like, okay, see you tomorrow. You know, it's bedtime.
Now with a horse, I think we need to talk about a little bit here. There's not a whole lot to study on the form. I'm talking about Sapphire Kitten. And by my handicapping skills, she's one of the fillies to beat in the juvenile turf fillies on Friday. She ran a very good race last time at Keeneland, second race of her life. Did you know going in that she was that class, that type of filly?
I'll tell you, I was actually talking to my assistant Cody yesterday, and you know, it's funny, the Kitten's Joy every year when the Ramsey van pulls up, and I was there and unloaded them myself at the Spectrum when the Ramsey van pulled up and had 9 on it, and she was the only filly. And, you know, they come off there and they're wide-eyed the first time out of the farm, and, you know, unless they'd been elsewhere. But she was very unassuming, like a lot of the Kitten's Joys can be. They're, you know, what I've noticed over the years with the Kitten's Joys is that, you know, the ones that are kind of going a little extra in the morning, staying on, and, you know, have that racehorse mentality. When you put them on the grass, they show up first time out. Having said that, when we ran her Kentucky Downs, you know, she definitely, I knew she'd run well, but, you know, we didn't have the opportunity to breeze her on the grass. We didn't have the opportunity to see what she would do when put on the grass, obviously, and she really the way she won that race was really impressive, and I knew added distance would only benefit her more.
That was a 6 furlong race,
correct?
Kentucky Downs.
Yeah. Well, you know, 3/4 of Kentucky Downs is a little more than 3/4 on a normal oval. But you know, fast forward to Keeneland, the Jesmond Harmonized Mott's Horse is a very nice filly. Had 3 starts or 2 short starts prior to that, going 2 turns, and you know, I think we gave her a run for her money, and I think that being our first time going 2 turns, I think that she's definitely going to move forward off of that. Physically, mentally, as far as Sapphire Kitten goes, I wouldn't trade places with anybody.
Excellent. Why don't we take that opportunity to show last month's Jessamine Stakes. Sapphire Kitten, coming off only that 6 furlong maiden race against the more experienced favorite, Harmonize. She gave her everything she wanted down the stretch.
And they're off to the J.P. Morgan Chase Jessamine Stakes. Carly Bell is being hustled away from the starting gate, comes right out for the early lead. Precious Love is there. Here's Mom's Choice, along with Family Tree, both moving up from the outside. It will be Carly Bell, long shot leader here early, down toward the inside. Mom's Choice draws alongside from second. That pair opens up by 3 lengths. Family Tree angles down toward the rail in third by 2 lengths. is followed closely now by Come to Mischief, who stays outward from the rail, moves up into fourth. Precious Love is fifth. Sapphire Kitten is in sixth. Clairview seventh toward the inside. Delicate Lady alongside of her in eighth. Lily's Dream ninth. Outsider Art is in tenth. And Harmonize, nowhere near the front of the field today, is near the back of the pack in the 11th position, placed outward from the rail. And then Tia Floor is in the 12th spot. Theory of Change is in 13th. Inconclusive is 14th, 22-2 for the quarter, 47 seconds for the opening half mile. And Carly Bell, 99-1 long shot, leads the field by four lengths into the far turn. Mom's Choice toward the outside, second, three parts of a length. Family Tree, third back toward the inside. And then Come to Mischief. Come to Mischief moves up on the outside, fourth, within 3.5 lengths of the leader now. Sapphire Kitten, outward from the rail, is in fifth position. Loses a spot to Precious Love. Harmonize, back in that 10th position, now has to go to the center of the course, nearly 10 lengths off the lead, has to angle very wide outside of Outsider Art. Here's Sapphire Kitten going to the lead. Harmonize and Outsider Art move as a pair out in the center of the course. What a sweeping move by Harmonize to collar Sapphire Kitten. These two going at it. Final furlong of the J.P. Morgan Chase Jessamine Stakes. Harmonize a narrow lead. Harmonize takes it by a neck with a breathtaking performance. Sapphire Kitten was home second, 1 minute, 44 seconds.
Joe, 1 year into being on your own, and now you have this filly running a great race, your second race of her life in the Jessamine. She almost beat probably one of the favorites, if not the favorite for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Turf filly. You've never had a Breeders' Cup horse, obviously, on your own, 1 year in. What would this mean to you if Sapphire Kitten ran a big race on Friday?
Well, you know, obviously we're honored to be there. I'll be honest that the loss of Shorerunner was really hard on us, and it's a little bittersweet. So, you know, Sapphire's kind of, in my mind, has come onto the scene late, and but it's been hard to get over that, the loss of Shorerunner, and I'm excited to have the opportunity to be in the Breeders' Cup. And, you know, I know we have a filly that's capable of winning it, and we have a strong undercard, and you know, I'm just honored in general to be where I am in my career in such a short time, and you know, get the respect of a lot of important owners and trainers that I respect a lot. So.
What do you expect to see a little bit in the race? Is she going to be coming from off the pace a little bit like last time, or?
You know, obviously, Julian's more than capable. I don't give a lot of instructions, so you know, get to the wire first.
You're going to leave it up to him. Huh? All right.
She's, so you said you watch replays until midnight some nights as looking for horses. That's what horse players do, right? So Breeders' Cup, all of us have been poring over replays. And you watch her replay, Harmonize, who's, I think, 7-2 on the morning line. Sapphire Kitten is 10-1. They're a neck apart.
Right.
Sapphire Kitten a good bet?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about, you say you don't give Julian that many instructions, but it does look like this race has enough pace in there. Does anything concern you about that? These are two-year-olds are going a mile. It's a quick run to that first turn. Anything along those lines?
You know, to be honest with you, Sapphire Kitten, mentally, she's a really strong filly. It's hard to hurt her feelings. So with her confidence, Julian's confidence, you know, whatever, however it shakes out, if she's up closer, if she's further back, I think she'll take whatever is thrown at her. So I know she's in tip-top condition, and, you know, obviously... the rest is up just up to racing luck, because I know the ability's there.
You get nervous? Are you nervous?
I'm kind of a nervous person anyway, because she'll tell you, I mean, I'll get nervous for a $5,000 claimer.
Mm-hmm.
I love my horses, and I love racing, and I work hard, and so I'm not, like, nervous because I'm in the Breeders' Cup. I'm just, every race that I know I have a good shot, I'm nervous.
Which is harder for you, Joe. You were a former rider, in case we all didn't know, and now, of course, you're a trainer. Is it harder being a trainer?
No, I'm a way better trainer than I was a jockey.
I always said I never understood. I'm like, when I used to ride for him when he was working for Mike, or even after he went on his own for a short period of time, I rode for him, and I was like, how, well, you know, why are you so nervous? Like, it's all on my shoulders now, you know, like, it's out of your... But then, you know, once I was working in the barn after I retired and working for him and sitting and watching all these races, I'm like, oh, that's why, because it's all out of my control now. Like, I know my horse is here ready to win, but if the race doesn't go the way that I'm hoping, then, you know, anything can happen. So
I guess what I'm getting out of this latest conversation is, if you want to know how to win a Breeders' Cup race, you can look to your wife, who's won two.
Yeah.
I'm just teasing.
I've looked up to her the whole time, so why not now?
I'd like to speak to that competitiveness that you talk about, though, Rosie, because you are very competitive as a rider, which is a great quality, obviously. A lot of great qualities to be a complete rider that you were. But now you're on the other side of it, like you said. How does that competitiveness compare, where you're in the barn with the horses in the morning, your husband's the trainer, he's trying to make a name for himself, every winner counts for something.
I'm Rosie's husband. What else do I need to do?
Big stage winners count for a lot more.
Well, but next weekend I might just be Joe's wife.
There you go. But I mean, the competitiveness for both of you. And Joe says he gets nervous. If I was a trainer, I would too, because you put so much hard work into these horses in the morning, and the results show during the afternoon when they actually run, there's still competitive juices for you, even though you're not riding in
that aspect.
Oh,
there's tons. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, especially at the fairgrounds in Saratoga is when I was most full force into the assistant position for Joe, and, you know, I really realized why he put so much pressure on himself and why there is so much, you know, nerves going into it, because, you know, he has claimed this horse or developed this horse from, you know, when it first came in as a off-the-farm two-year-old, such as Sapphire Kitten. You've done all that you can. You've gone through all the setbacks that, you know, every horse and every, you know, training scenario goes through. And you get to this race, and then, you know, once they leave the paddock, it's all out of your hands. And so, you know, I guess I had a more of appreciation for a bad ride on this side of it, because, I mean, and having said that, I have spent many times defending riders after races with Joe, because I can kind of see both sides of it. I know that, you know, sometimes you just ride a bad race, and every single jockey that there ever was has ridden a bad race, and will do so in any kind of race, whether it's a $5,000 claim or a Breeders' Cup race. It happens. Then there are also times where you are just dealt bad cards, and there's nothing you can do. And so that's where I feel like I defend a lot. It's like, Joe, that trip was terrible, but I don't think I saw any opportunity for this jock to do anything different. So, you know, once it comes down to it, you put in all those hours, he's put in all the time into claiming the horse or developing the horse, training the horse and getting the horse that race, and then it's all out of your hands. And if the trip doesn't go well, that's the way it is. There's no redo. So so I definitely appreciate, you know, the competitiveness of being on the ground and watching and having everything out of your control during the race.
Interesting. So it's funny. So there's all sorts of different avenues in horse racing. There's trainers, horsemen, owners, jockeys, and then there's horse players. And horse players love to pigeonhole trainers into certain roles. For example, Christophe Clément is a turf trainer only. Oh, by the way, he's got Tonus in the Breeders' Cup Classic, right? You've sort of been pigeonholed a claiming trainer, despite the fact you have a filly in a Breeders' Cup race on the grass. It's not a claiming race, obviously.
And she's 2 years old.
And she's 2 years old, right. Speak about that a little bit.
Well, you know, it's funny, and I've actually had a couple owners that, or one owner that comes to mind that I respect a lot, and is a very, you know, down-to-earth kind of person, and was concerned about me being labeled like that. And I explained it the same. I've explained it before. You know, yes, I had support of Ramsey. Yes, I had support of Brad Grady. Yes, I had. But I knew to go out to get, I couldn't just say, hey, I'm Joe Sharp. I'm Rosie's husband. I'm Mike Maker's assistant. Send me your horses. You know, I had some support to claim horses. So I went out. I did my homework. I claimed horses. And I tried to develop them the best I could, because that's what I had to work with at the time. I went on my own at the end of September, October. They're not handing out two-year-olds at that time of year. So with that, you know, claim the horses, and, you know, like we already touched on, how they've done since then, since January. And I wanted to get people's attention by winning, and I was aggressive, and we won. We raised some, we dropped some, but for the most part, we raised them, and we won a lot of races. We raised a lot of attention. And with that, I wanted to stay hot through the spring so that we would get the chance to have some nice two-year-olds. And that worked out. I think we got close to about 35 two-year-olds from all different avenues. Delridge has sent us a few, Ramsey's, Brad Grady, Edie McGee, you know, list goes on. And fast forward, you know, I think that my two-year-old starters have been kind of under, like, oh, he's not a two-year-old trainer. He hasn't, you know, at 11% hasn't won a lot with two-year-olds. Well, a lot of the two-year-olds that I got were two-year-olds that are going to run a mile on the grass, mile on, you know, Kitten's Joys, this kind of like, you know, RNAs from sales, things like that. Statistically, I haven't sent many home. You know, the ones we were sent, for the most part, we all still have, and, you know, they're coming on the scene late, but they're coming on well. And I didn't, though everybody else put me under a lot of pressure to be a good two-year-old guy and to, you know, crack it right out of the box with them, and I didn't let it affect the decisions I made in getting them ready. And I have a good solid barn of young horses that have been developed properly, that are sound, and that I think are going to have a great fall and a great spring and a great three-year-old year. And, you know, I feel like my owners are pretty pleased.
You said 11%, whatever the number was, even if it was just conjecture. Horse players also like, you know, such and such as 25% second off the layoff, or, you know, 15% sprint to route. This guy can't go turf to dirt. Are those statistics hogwash, or is there something to them?
You know, I think, you know, Mike and I were talking the other day, because about a couple months ago, about percentages, and he goes, you know, just they're all a bunch of. You know, I think that obviously we're strong first off the claim, close to 30%. So that obviously has to do with your placement. You know, I think there's something to be said, like, for first time out. Trainers that don't win first time out. Shug's one that doesn't win a lot first time out, and is Hall of Fame, unbelievable, you know, best that's ever lived. You know, he's great. Yeah. And I think you just have to be comfortable in your own skin and your own training regimen. And I think the thing that makes that separates jockeys, trainers, anybody in the business or any profession is consistency, and just knowing and being confident in what you've learned and what you believe in. And no matter what people try to dissect and place you and categorize you, sticking to the regimen that you know works, and, you know, blocking that out until you can produce the results that they were looking for. So
I've seen a lot of great trainers over the years be considered claiming trainers. Bobby Frankel comes to mind.
A lot of them, yes. They have to start somewhere.
Yeah, right? Yeah, they have to start somewhere, but they were certainly labeled a claiming trainer, and then all of a sudden, grade one races are popping off like crazy.
I guess my thought on the deal is, if you can do well with claiming horses and win stakes with, you know, horses you claim, then if given the horses with the pedigrees and the, you know, sound foundation, you should be able to hopefully develop those into great stakes winners.
But let's talk about the difference between 2-year-old racing, 3-year-old racing. The 3-year-old year for colt and for fillies, that's the most lucrative year potentially for any horse. Running against strictly 3-year-olds, you've got the entire year to work with. Different horses have different physicality, different mental capabilities, and they need to learn more, some of them more than others, moving forward. How do you take that Sapphire Kitten or some of the other horses in your barn and map out a short-term and long-term plan to maximize their earning potential?
I think that each horse is definitely an individual. I think there's horses that'll come in that, you know, are precocious, quick. You probably need to try and bang out as much earnings quickly as you can, because the rest of them, when they catch up in size and in pedigree, you're going to leave them in the dust. You know, you get those 2-year-old fillies or 2-year-old colts that come in, they're quick, you know, they look like they'll win right away, and you maximize on things like that, because, you know, as they get to be 3-year-olds, they might separate from them. So I think identifying that can help you get a quick ROI. And then also noticing, like I touched on, as far as, you know, knowing that a horse is going to be long on the grass, long on the dirt, and just, you know, not coming under the, being under the gun. And that's one thing I give a lot of my owners, and especially Grady and Ramsey, Dee Dee, all those, that they haven't put any pressure to start them any sooner than I was ready to. And they let you, I think that knowing the family of the, you know, knowing the family, knowing what they're supposed to be, watching what they're telling you, and knowing they're going to be a good 3-year-old, helps you manage them and not be in a hurry when they're 2-year-olds. And Hopefully, you know, next year the proof will be in the pudding. But I think that each case individual, because obviously, like you said, you have ones that you need to probably win with right away because their two-year-old year is going to be the best year. You have ones that are going to be better three-year-olds, and you have ones that, you know, hit five and six and come into themselves, such as a horse like Shore Runner. So.
Before we jump into some more Rosie highlights, we did have one question come in from our large studio audience. Joe, what, no one's going to laugh at that? No, nothing?
All right. I was going to be like, wait a minute.
Joe, what do you look for? You're obviously you're doing great climbing horses, but is there some specific things you look for in these horses that you're about to drop a claim on?
Well, I usually have different owners that are looking for horses at different times, and I know that certain owners have certain kind of horses that they look for, somewhat. Maidens, somewhat turf sprinters, somewhat anything with a good rag number. Physically, you look at a horse that's balanced, you look at a horse that, I'm not a guy, I think a lot of people try and, not a lot of people, but I think people sometimes, you know, when they go to claim a horse, want to try and swing it out of the park and say, well, if we claim off this really low percentage trainer, the horse looks terrible, we, you know, give it some TLC, we're going to make it twice the horse. I don't look for that. I look for a horse that's, you know, in good condition, well balanced. Maybe think something that you think you can change, whether it be the distance, the surface, blinkers on, off. And I try and, you know, the better the product that I have to start with, I feel like I can, you know, the better I have, the less that goes into developing something even greater. So, you know, some of the guys who I have the most respect for, such as, you know, the list could go on and on, but the guys that I'll send a claim off of are not necessarily, you know, low percentage trainers. They're guys that are good trainers, that good horsemen, and I know the horse is in good flesh and has the pedigree that could develop into a nice horse.
So I got a follow up to that, because this is an example into what you're speaking of. Officer Griffin, who runs for 25, it's 4-5, he gets beat. Does not look good to me crossing the finish line. Did not run well. You claimed him. After that result, you had to be, you know, maybe a little bit concerned. You run him right back and he airs. He runs one of the best races of his life. Comes back Mountaineer again. You talk about the placement. Little stake there. You win again. You know, and he runs in a grade three. Very representative effort. Now he's back in a Keeneland and an 80 optional three other than. What did you see in him, and what key did you turn to make him revert back to his best form again?
Well, to be honest with you, I passed on him for 50 at Keeneland. And I looked at him for 50.
Bargain shopper over here.
And I passed on him because I thought there was, you know, I thought that was a lot to pay. I thought that was definitely paying top dollar. And he ran bad that day. I think a lot of it was racing luck. But when he dropped him for 25, I didn't bite, and he won. And that's the day Ingrid claimed him. So when he came back for the 25... You know, he's a fast horse. He's a game horse. He shows up every time. Obviously, you know, he this, that, and the other. He's been through the mill, but he's always right there. He's a horse that's, you know, Ingrid had him in great condition. Paul McGee had him in great condition. And he's gotten confident. I claimed him for 25. You know, he won an off-the-turf race at Indiana Downs. Perfect scenario. Lone speed. Looked like a superstar. You know, goes up to Mountaineer 4.5. He really impressed me that day. I mean, out of the 12 holes, should have never won. I mean, I almost scratched this. I mean, he had no prayer from out there. Corey did a fantastic job. And I mean, the horse, you know, pinned his ears and mowed him down the lane. Galloped out great. You know, he's gotten confident. And the turf monster, we knew we were taking a big swing there, but he didn't disappoint it. I mean, you know, obviously he didn't place, but he ran well. And he's just a neat horse. He's all race horse, and he's gone above and beyond what we expected when we claimed him. So,
is there such thing as horse confidence? So they know when they're winning, they know when they're losing.
Oh, absolutely. I think one of my biggest attributes, one of the best things that I do for horses, I think state of mind is very important. And I think it's the same as if you're a basketball player and your coach, you know, pats you on the back, says good job. You know, if you go to work every day and somebody makes you feel like your job, like you do a terrible job, or they talk down to you and make you feel bad, I think that it starts to reflect in the way you work. Same with a racehorse. You know, I think if you treat them like a big horse, especially, you know, colts and geldings, and you mess with them, and you know, whatever, and you can kind of build. You see them just kind of build on you. I get on a lot of my own horses, and you see them just kind of start to change, and their eye softens up a little bit, and they kind of look, you know, want to be there. So.
What about the difference in the training? And Rosie can speak to this too. In the morning, some of them can really frustrate you. You think they have a ton of talent. They're not showing as much as you think they should in the afternoon. And then maybe they have a light bulb moment. Is that a fair assessment? I mean, how does that, is it gradual or is it just one day that they just figure it out, whether it be in training or in a race?
Were you asking me?
Both of you guys. Both.
I mean, there's some that you just know it's there. And it doesn't matter how cheap you run them, they won't win. And there's some...
I can attest to that.
And you just get so frustrated. And then there's others that are just very unassuming in the morning and just give it their heart and soul in the afternoon. You're like, wow. Like, so, no, it's they're all different, but they're like kids, they're like people. And I, you know, though I have 90 head, I spend a lot of... try to spend a pretty good amount of time with all at every place, and you know, I feel like I still know all my horses pretty well, and I'm trying to individualize each one of them and kind of bring out their personalities.
And how does that work for you, Rosie, when you were riding and then obviously watching the development of horses too? Do you agree with everything Joe says, or is it a little bit different when you're in the races competing at a very high level to see, oh, Untappable was the best she's ever been this day, maybe she backed off her best form a little bit, and then you maybe see a horse like that starting to come back to their best? I mean, there's ebb and flow.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the confidence issue is definitely definitely plays a part in how a horse can perform. And you know, I could see some of it in Joe's training when he was an assistant and riding, you know, some of the horses that he was working with a little bit. But then when I was in the barn full time for him after I retired, it's just funny. I could come up with funny examples of confidence building skills.
That's what we're all
that
about.
Joe
here.
Uses.
Funny examples.
No, one funny example is, I think it was a horse called Bell by the Ridge.
Illinois bred.
Bell by the Ridge. That Joe came in the barn and I think the horse finally dropped you. And he said, Bell by the Ridge dropped me today. And he felt so good about himself. And I let him, you know, trot down to the next stall so that, you know, and the guy was waiting down there to catch him so that he would feel good about himself.
One time, Harmonize, remember? Harmonizer at Belmont, he came back, old horse, you know, was kind of trying to get him back his head right. So I was like, we're coming back in the barn. We had the whole barn, so it wasn't a big deal. And I jumped off of him, so he felt like he dropped me. And I was expecting him to, like, jog down the shed row and like cut up. It was a couple of days before I was trying to, you know, kind of engage him a little bit, and he like walked two strides, looked at me.
But, no, but I mean, that's just an example.
Trying to trick
horses,
I never knew that.
This horse dropped me today, and he felt so good about himself, and you know, or you know, horse. I can't remember which horse it was.
That doesn't happen very
often. I remember. No, it's not like our normal thing.
But, the other horse drops, and then finally this one does.
No, but I remember him. I don't even remember which horse it was, but I remember a specific time in the post where he's like, make sure you slap him around on the neck a little bit and get him feeling good about himself and get him pumped up. You know, turn him loose. And then that's who it was, yeah.
He's my stable pony.
Yeah. And he's a stable, yeah, and he went and bought him back for $1,000.
I bought him for $1,000
at
Mountaineer this summer. When I went with Aztec Brave and Officer Griffin, horse that had been, she'd won a few races on. And
really cool horse. Really, really cool horse.
And I saw he was getting, you know, it's kind of coming, his career was definitely coming to an end. And I found the trainer and got his number and called him, and he sold him to us and picked him up. He was in great condition, and anyway, made him our stable pony. You know, it was a pretty cool deal.
Yeah, he was a cool horse. He was one that, like, you know, you got to keep him. And he was a horse that was a starter allowance horse for Mike that Joe had under his was overseen for most of the time he was with Mike, and he was. And I rode him a lot. He was a funny little horse, and it's so funny that he's just been a great pony and, you know, good personality. But that's, you know, bringing out that personality and the confidence was very instrumental in the few specific horses that I know that I can think of.
I've heard of that. I've never heard of that specific. That's fascinating.
Yeah, yeah.
So who are you falling off tomorrow?
Can't we bet next time?
Not right.
Falling off tomorrow. So
when are they going to have like fell off in morning in the TV so we know?
Right next to the workout.
Yeah, exactly.
Sharp on.
That's fascinating. That's probably the coolest thing we've heard on this since we've been doing this.
No, so to go back to my favorite horse that we were talking about earlier. He was a horse that came with a really bad reputation. He doesn't like to train. He boxy wheels. He does this. He's dangerous. He's dangerous. You know, don't let Rosie ride him. So, like, when I was at the harness track, first of all, I have to go out of the harness track. We were stabled in the center of the harness training track. So, in the morning, the trotters would trot by our barn, literally 20 feet. No rail, no nothing. And I have this crazy horse that I'm, like, not... And Joe even told me, like, don't ride that horse. And I'm like, whatever. Joe puffed his chest out and said, I'll get on that. And so I said, I'm taking him out first set before Joe gets over here. So, but, you know, I'm thinking, okay, you know, actually, you did get on the first day.
I got
day.
On the first
you
day.
You did get on the first day. But he was a very bad day. Boy that day. Yeah. He showed me.
He's definitely a chick mount.
He definitely was bucking with Joe, and the trotters were setting him off, and he was showing me definitely what he was capable of. I mean, he was a bad boy. So I would take him, like, literally from the trotter training track to the track up at the main track of Saratoga, or actually Clare Court we used to train him on, which is a little small track you couldn't even breeze on. It's like, what is it, at half a mile? So but I would literally take him like on a different path every single morning through the barns so that he didn't get bored enough to think, well, how can I get, you know, what am I going to do now? I'll just drop my rider, you know. So, but I mean, that's,
and now he's real straightforward.
Yeah, he's real straightforward and he loves to train. So it's it's definitely cool. Horses have personalities like people. Oh, and you know, I got to see a lot of it when I was riding in the races, like how horses would, you know, compete and be competitive or non-competitive against each other. And then it's just even more fun being in the barn with them every day and like trying to bring that out in them so that they can bring out their best.
What do you mean when you're riding competitive?
When I was riding races.
So like a horse that wants to be inside, he wants to be outside?
Horses that would love to come through like a tight, you know, tight hole, or horses that had to be outside that, you know, an older horse that was a come from behind sprinter that, you know, that you let them sit and settle and run at their own pace, and when you turn for home, they're going to fly home on the outside. I mean, there's all kinds of different little idiosyncrasies is the word I was looking for.
Rosie, was there a most confident horse that you could say that you've ever ridden?
That is a very tough question. I mean, I think Shanghai Bobby actually was a very confident horse, but he was also a horse that was like, he was kind of confident, but it's like such a playboy that he never really took anything that seriously, and he was that good that he just delivered because he was all talent, and, you know, he was confidence, but a little bit of distracted confidence at times. One of the coolest horses that I've ridden.
Nice. Now, you told us before we got on the air that you, at one point during last year's Breeders' Cup Dirt Mile, you were pretty darn confident that Tapiture could get the job done. Conversely, Shanghai Bobby, when you won your first Breeders' Cup, the Breeders' Cup.
Yeah, he probably gave me the opposite impression.
I was going to ask. Yeah, it looked like he was in trouble there for a while.
At the 3/8 pole in the Breeders' Cup Dirt Mile last year on Tapiture, seeing as the way Golden Sense were in that race, you know, fast on the front end, and I was, you know, coming around, had a nice trip, easy. Tapiture is a really straightforward, easy horse to ride, and we were passing horses. I just had power underneath me, and I was like, wow, we're going to lose, absolutely no way. And all the credit to Golden Sense for just, you know, being the class that he was to win that race anyway. And Tapiture ran a great race. Now, Shanghai Bobby, on the other hand, ran, you know, an incredible first half mile in the Breeders' Cup in 2012 juvenile. And
looked like there was just a cavalry charge.
Yeah, but while coming to the quarter pole, you know, I kind of inherited the lead from a horse that, you know, probably wasn't going to last. Evidently wasn't going to last. And Shanghai Bobby, like, looked in, at the crowd and said, oh, we're in front, woo, you know, at the quarter pole. And I was like, oh, crap, you know, like, we're never going to make it. And so I was actually hoping in that race, I said, I hope they come to me right now as opposed to at the eighth pole, because if they come to me now, he's going to run on. But if they come to me at the eighth pole, it's going to be too late. And he, I mean, it was a grueling first quarter, first half in that race. And, I mean, we went 22 and change, 45.
Right.
And he, I mean, we were crawling at that lane, but it was because he was distracted more than being exhausted. And for a horse to pick up the way he did with the amount of volume of horses that was about to swallow us and keep his nose in front, I mean, he's an incredible race horse.
Very
nice. I can't wait to see his offspring.
Interesting. Now, your other Breeders' Cup winner maybe gave you a little bit more confidence the entire race. That was Untappable. And Rosie, let's go watch that race right now.
All right, Tom, all in line. They're off in the Longines Breeders' Cup Distaff. And Tis Midnight comes off quickly from the inside, and there goes the mare from Peru, Valiant Amelia, alongside between those two, Iotapa. And now Iotapa and Tis Midnight, the two Californians, will battle it out early. L'Amour de ma vie now squeezes through on the inside into third. Valiant Amelia fourth. Untappable and Close Hatches are right together. Untappable is wide, Close Hatches is even farther out wide on that first turn. Then Rhea Antonia, followed by a ground-saving Belle Galante. Four lengths to Unbridled Forever. Stanwyck is second last, and Don't Tell Sophia trails. 22 and 4 for the opening quarter mile. A brisk pace for their run up the backstretch, set by Tis Midnight, who's a neck in front of Iotapa. L'Amour de ma vie right in behind them. Close Hatches is close up running and fourth to the outside of her. Rhea Antonia is down on the inside. Valiant Amelia. And then comes Untappable. She is now 4.5 lengths off the lead up the backstretch. Belle Galante is next. They went 46 and 3 for a half mile. The pace has settled somewhat. Stanwyck Unbridled Forever and Don't Tell Sophia continues to buy time at the back as Tis Midnight and Iotapa continue their scramble into the far turn. They are stride for stride on the lead. Close Hatches and now Untappable is moving up on the outside. Untappable is on the charge. Close Hatches is not going on. She's dropping back again today. And Don't Tell Sophia is rocketing by horses on the far outside. They're at the top of the stretch. And Untappable has taken the lead on the outside of Iotapa. Don't Tell Sophia is third on the far outside. Untappable into the final 16th in front. On the inside, Iotapa fights on. Don't Tell Sophia's third. But as they come to the wire, the Super Filly has done it. Untappable has won the Distaff. It's close for second between Iotapa and Don't Tell Sophia. Rhea Antonio is fourth. Untappable, a champion.
Thank you, Tom, along with Bill Farish, the chairman of the Breeders' Cup, and Craig Fravel, the president and CEO of the Breeders' Cup. We're here to make the presentation for the Longines Breeders' Cup Distaff, the trophy, and a very special gift from Longines. It's Juan Carlos Capelli, the VP of International Marketing. Juan Carlos?
Yes. Hello, everybody. I'm very proud to be here for the first time as official timekeeper of the Breeders' Cup. And I'm very proud to give a watch to the winner of today. He won already the Longines Kentucky Oaks and today the Longines Breeders' Cup Distaff. And congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And Ron Winchell, that's 6-7 now for this horse. We saw the first weekend there in May look so great in the Kentucky Oaks. Our Jerry Bailey said, the best filly in America now, no question. Certainly looked the part today.
Absolutely. It was a fantastic year. I don't even know what I could possibly say. Winning marquee races like that is the reason you're in the business.
And to come here and do it at the Breeders' Cup, obviously, as big a stage as the sport has, it has to make it extra special.
Extra special is putting it mildly.
Mildly. Lafitte, you're over there with another familiar face.
Winning rider Rosie Napravnik and her mother, Cindy, very proud of her daughter and what she's accomplished today. Rosie, your second victory on a Breeders' Cup stage, Shanghai Bobby in the Juvenile a couple of years ago. You win the Kentucky Oaks, the Breeders' Cup Distaff with Untappable. What does this filly mean to your career?
First, I just want to thank Steve and Ron Winchell for having me on the filly to begin with and also letting me get back on her after I was injured. As far as how much it means to me, I can't really explain, but I'm going to have to explain it to my mom first. I wanted to tell you in person that my retirement starts on Sunday, and Joe and I are starting a family. I told you I was going to give you good TV.
Congratulations on the win and your growing family, Rosie. Wow, what a moment. Steve, this filly, what makes her so special?
She's a tremendous amount of talent. Just, I think that it's just the Winchell breeding program and the talent that she has, and just can't say how proud I am. You know, Rosie gave her some tremendous trips this year and the culmination of a great year for a great filly.
Rosie, why now? Why announce your retirement now and decide to tell your mother on this stage?
Well, I wasn't going to tell anybody until Sunday, but I figured it couldn't be a better way to go out with this filly. She means so much to me. Like I said, I'm so thankful for Steve and Winchell Farm, the whole family. But I wanted to tell my mom in person, so I had to bring her up on stage because I didn't want to tell everybody else first.
What a performance, Untappable. Congratulations, everyone.
What a Breeders' Cup moment that was. Rosie Napravnik riding Untappable to Breeders' Cup distaff victory. And then, of course, after the race, dropping a bombshell. 7 weeks pregnant, retiring from racing, one of the top riders in the country. Rosie, Untappable hasn't been the same since you got off her back. Is there a story there?
I know that a lot of people have said that, and Untappable misses Rosie, and you know, blah blah blah. If she was riding, if she was this, if she was that. In my opinion, first of all, Johnny Velasquez is one of the greatest riders I've ridden with, and probably one of the greatest riders of all time. I'm just glad I'm not the one getting all the flack since she hasn't won as many races this year. But if you look at it as a whole, she has run 6 times this year, 4 of them grade ones, and she has not been worse than third. And she's run very credible races, and I think she's gotten a lot lack of credit for it. And also, having said that, in my experience riding her, I wouldn't say that the surfaces of tracks like Oaklawn and Belmont and Saratoga, they're all very, very deep surfaces. My mm-hmm. best races with her were Fairgrounds and Churchill and Santa Anita, where the surfaces are a little bit harder and faster. And she's been running on those deeper New York tracks all year and still running well. To me, it doesn't look like those are her preferred surfaces. So it's very disappointing not to see her run this weekend.
Yeah.
I was really looking forward to seeing her run this weekend, but they say they're going to run her next year, so I'm still a big fan of hers, and of course, cheering her on.
With good reason. I mean, she's been knocking on the door. She certainly would have had a real shot Friday in the distaff. Would you care to say that she was one of the best horses you've ever ridden, or give us a clue as to maybe who that would be?
Absolutely. She is definitely probably one of, if not the, all my all-time favorite horses. She was her aura that she presented all the time was just, you know, I'm a champion, here I am, and you're going to do things at my mercy.
Which you're speaking for her? For
yes,
you?
For her.
For her, okay.
No, she was riding her, I got along with her really well, but she was kind of an ask, don't tell type of filly, and you know, I think
your own personalities were very similar.
Yes, that could have been it. Yes, ask, don't tell. But I just always enjoyed riding her and being part of that team with Steve and Winchell Farm. Steve did an excellent job, has always done an excellent job with her. She's, I guess she can be considered to be somewhat difficult, but I never felt that way. Things always went smoothly when I rode her. She did get tougher and tougher and tougher to breeze as I, you know, as time went on. She was just, you know, that caliber of racehorse, and she was tough. But to ride her, she was a great filly to ride. She would, you know, in the first half of the race, give you all that confidence, like you were talking about, like for example, in the Breeders' Cup. And then, like once you get to the half mile pole on her, it's like you kind of have to start riding her as if you're not sure whether or not you have that much horse. And it was like, I would always like panic, like, how much horse do I have? And then when you get to the quarter pole, you've ridden her to that cruising point, and then she's just, and you're like, well, what was I worried about, you know? And she just always had that extra gear that you just kind of had to get into it, and then she would just go on, and I got it, we're good. So she was, she's definitely one of my favorite racehorses of all time.
What happened in the Haskell last year with her?
The Haskell was probably one of the not a very good trip. She had a tendency, sometimes she would not break so well, and I think we broke just a step behind and got a very, very, very wide trip. I probably also underestimated Edgar Prado for the 1,000,000th time, who was breaking right inside of me, and he ended up in the spot that I wanted. I probably rode maybe a little not aggressively enough out of the gate, thinking that I would get the spot, and I didn't, and which led us to be a little bit behind the ball, and she had so much work to do around the outside competing against a very tough horse. I think she ran a hell of a race that day and beat a lot of good horses and was very, you know, didn't get beat far by the rest.
Right. Well, it was
Byron. Not easy to do.
You can't break slow at
Monmouth.
If you break faster slow, you're done there.
Guys, this has been so much fun, but believe it or not, we're almost to the end of the hour already, unfortunately. Before we do break for the night, though, I think we should talk Breeders' Cup Classic just a little bit. We do have a Triple Crown winner running, American Pharoah, of course, Beholder, Keen Ice, Frosted, Honor Code, Tonalist. Do we have any favorites going into the Breeders' Cup Classic? Joe, I'll ask you first.
I mean, obviously, I'm on the American Pharoah bandwagon.
Really just stepping out on the limb there, are you?
But I like Honor Code.
Honor Code?
Yeah.
Okay. Coming from last.
Yeah, you know, I think that the race could set up for him. But I mean, in all honesty, hands down, I think American Pharoah, obviously, I'm not telling you anything you don't know, is the best horse in the race. But I think that Honor Code's a good horse, and he has the right kind of running style if somebody tries to crash American Pharoah's party.
Kind of amazes me, I don't know about you guys, but everything American Pharoah has accomplished. I know Travis, he's not the horse you've been betting all year, but everything he's accomplished, those 8 wins in a row, Triple Crown, finally he gets beat in a pretty good performance in the Travers, and everybody's ready to try to kind of beat him. They think that he's more than vulnerable. I'm not sure. I mean, American Pharoah has just been so good. How about you, Rosie?
I have been an American Pharoah fan since before any of you other people were.
There was a groupie, like, for a horse that Rosie was like,
American
Pharoah
is
really,
like,
yeah,
the first horse I am like a super fan of, and you know, all this happened after I retired pretty much because he scratched out the Breeders' Cup. But actually, I became a fan of American Pharoah in September of 2014 when he ran in the Front Runner. And I saw him that day in person when he was walking around the paddock before the race, and I was just in awe of him. Like, just
how, really?
As a 2-year-old, not how really big he was, and he had this presence. And then obviously he went on to win that race by many, and then, you know, all these other impressive Triple Crown races.
Did you ride that race?
No, I did not. I was there to ride another Breeders' Cup Prep race.
That's before me.
In the end of September.
Yeah.
I have been a huge fan of American Pharoah. I think that he is one heck of a horse. But I also, if there was a horse to beat him, I think I would also look at Honor Code. Another horse I actually rode in the race when Honor Code first started at Saratoga a couple of years ago. And I was on a horse, can't remember who the horse was, but I was last, and I was at the quarter pole, and Honor Code came inside of me in the slop on the rail, flying so fast, and I was like, holy moly, who is that? And he went on to win that race, and it was extremely impressive. So I've kind of been a little bit of a fan of Honor Code the whole time, too, but American Pharoah would be my pick, and obviously I am all for the Baffert team and supporting them and the Triple Crown winner. I think he's super special horse.
Two questions to sort of follow that up, because you mentioned Shug. I mean, when Shug, Honor Code Shug, winning early, obviously the horse has talent, but as a trainer, American Pharoah has maintained grade one top caliber form for over a year now. Is that horse, is that trainer, I mean, how hard is it to keep a horse at that level for so long? And it's not just that level, I mean, this is Triple Crown level.
I wish I could tell you.
that's about the best
that's
answer
a perfect
to give,
answer.
Right?
Maybe. Perfect answer. I get one question off Twitter. They wanted to know the turf course at Keeneland. It's the first time Breeders' Cup's going to be here. Is it unique in any certain way compared to other turf courses? Anything to think about for the horse players that are watching?
I think that I don't have any experience riding over it. Rosie does, obviously. But I think that Keeneland does a great job of managing all their services, regardless of the negative publicity that they tried to put on them at the beginning of the meet. I think that Beasley does a great job. And I think that they do a good job for the horsemen. I think the track is well manicured. I think that it was a run of bad luck. And I think that myself personally, I feel very confident every day I train at Keeneland and every day I run at Keeneland on both surfaces.
What about the turf course in terms of running style? Saving ground is always a good thing in turf racing. What about there? Anything specific that we can apply to the Breeders' Cup this year?
I think Keeneland is, track-wise, it's a great place to have the Breeders' Cup because you have all the different distances. You know, you have the two-turn races and the sprint races. On the dirt, you have the 7-furlongs race, which I guess there's no Breeders' Cup races going that distance. But all around, I love that track for all the different distances and its dynamics. As far as the turf course goes, it seems like, and all the times I've ridden it and even watching it now, for some reason, it seems like the races are run where the first quarter is fast, and then like you have a lot of 23-48s. Mm-hmm. Like they have a fast first quarter, and then they, you know, when it is riding a race, you think you're setting up in a great spot, and then all of a sudden you're running up everyone's behind. Mm-hmm. And I think, I'm not really sure how that plays out in the dynamic of the race, but, you know, I think it's a pretty fair turf course. It's not like a super speed bias. It's not, you know, you have to come from behind, like a course like Fairgrounds has been labeled. And Saving Ground, obviously, very, very important. The only thing I can say about Keeneland that I think is a little bit unique is it seems like on the inside it has an ultra slant down to the rail. So when I would ride, like, right on the rail, I would feel a disadvantage because you're on lower ground. It's softer ground. That's the only thing in particular I can say about Keeneland, but I think it's a great course.
Well, that's perfect. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah.
So, Rosie, when you talk about riding, the octave in your voice goes up a little bit. So I have a two-part question. How much do you miss it? And I know the percentage probably fluctuates day by day, but from 0 to 100%, what's the percentage that you may be back on the program someday?
I would say the percentage of being a jock again has always and will continue to be very, very low. I do miss it a lot in times like leading up to the Breeders' Cup.
Mortgage payments.
Things like that, you know. when I see my bank account only going down.
Hey, come on.
Wait till Friday.
But no, I mean, it's when American Pharoah is winning the Triple Crown and leading up to Breeders' Cup, and he's got a horse, you know, long on the grass, one of my favorite races to ride in the Breeders' Cup. Kentucky Downs, you know, one of the weirdest tracks of, you know, a completely different dimension, and the purses are $120,000. I miss it. It's not really about the money, but it's I miss the really good class of horses, and you know, it was obviously every class of horse that got me to be able to ride at that level. But that's really what I miss: the Shanghai Bobbies, the Untappables, the good horses.
Interviews with the media.
Though that would be my number one. I'm glad you touched on that because I forgot to mention all of the media.
Rosie, you can come here anytime you want, whether the camera's on or not. We can talk.
I think
horses.
I am well known for loving doing interviews and just, you know, taking my time out of the day to.
Do you interview her at home?
No, I just feel like, you know, she's been humbled by my. She's like,
how important is it to you though? Because you got to do interviews all the time now. You're sitting here with us. You got to do post race interviews after stakes.
She taught me well.
Yeah. Well. Yeah.
Honestly, you know, I used to get nervous, and I don't really get nervous anymore. But she and Rosie was the same. She used to not do interviews well when we first started dating, and you know, we kind of grew together and.
I used to do them even worse before we started.
Yeah.
When I was really young.
No, I didn't really like her. but no, it's gotten easier, and I don't, like I said, we got a good support system with each other and everybody else around us, so it makes it easy.
That's great. This was fun.
Yeah, good
time. This was good. Yeah. We should do this more often. Joe, I didn't get your Breeders' Cup Classic pick.
You know what? And I've been a fan all year, too. And I liked Keen Ice and the Travers, but I couldn't bet because I was watching that race as a fan. I'd say I'm 51% fan, 49% player. And in the Classic, I'm probably 90% fan, 10% player. I want to see him go out on top. So I'll be rooting for American Pharoah.
I'm going to be the contrarian in case anyone doesn't know yet. Frosted didn't get him in the Derby, the Belmont, the Travers, the Haskell, but Frosted is going to beat American Pharoah in the Breeders' Cup Classic.
Be fun. I'm going to the turf trainer, Christoph Clement, with Tonalist.
Tonalist.
If Frosted or Tonalist wins, that receptacle over there, that's where all my tickets are going to go. Because I won't be cashing any of them if those two horses win. Yeah.
Good luck with Seth Arkin.
Yeah, good luck.
Thank you guys.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Joe, for being here. Thank you, Rosie. Joe, Travis, we were brought to you by Keeneland Select tonight, folks. We'll be back tomorrow night, strictly handicapping the Breeders' Cup. See you then.
Wait, we got one more thing to say, which is the Derby Wars webcast is coming on after this as well. So give us 5 or 10 minutes. We'll be right back with a live game. We're going to talk a lot of Breeders' Cup with Josh Frederick and myself and special guests, so stick around.